Good evening, and welcome to our continuing series on the life divine with our beloved Ranga. Namaste. We are continuing in chapter 17, the divine soul, beginning with the fourth paragraph. Its consciousness would not be shut out from any part of the infinite truth.
We read the para. Its consciousness would not be shut out from any part of the infinite truth, nor limited by any poise or status that it might assume in its relations with others, nor condemned to any loss of self-knowledge by its acceptance of a purely phenomenal individuality and the play of practical differentiation. It would, in its self-experience, live eternally in the presence of the Absolute. To us, the Absolute is only an intellectual conception of indefinable existence. The intellect tells us simply that there is a Brahman higher than the highest, an unknowable that knows itself in other fashion than that of our knowledge. But the intellect cannot bring us into its presence. The divine soul, living in the truth of things, would, on the contrary, always have the conscious sense of itself as a manifestation of the Absolute. Its immutable existence it would be aware of as the original self-form of that transcendent, Satchidananda. Its play of conscious being it would be aware of as manifestation of that in forms of Satchidananda. In its every state or act of knowledge, it would be aware of the unknowable cognizing itself by a form of variable self-knowledge. In its every state or act of power, will or force, aware of the transcendence, possessing itself by a form of conscious power of being and knowledge. A conscious power of being and knowledge. In its every state or act of delight, joy or love, aware of the transcendence, embracing itself by a form of conscious self-enjoyment. This presence of the Absolute would not be with it as an experience occasionally glimpsed or finally arrived at and held with difficulty, or as an addition, acquisition or culmination superimposed on its ordinary state of being. It would be the very foundation of its being, both in the unity and the differentiation. It would be present to it in all its knowing, willing, doing, enjoying. It would be absent neither from its timeless self nor from any moment in time, neither from its spaceless being nor from any determination of its extended existence, neither from its unconditioned purity beyond all cause and circumstance, nor from any relation of circumstance, condition and causality. This constant presence of the Absolute would be the basis of its infinite freedom and delight, ensure its security in the play, and provide the root and sap and essence of its divine being.
Marvelous.
So this is the description of the divine soul.
Yes.
It is absolute in everything, in its existence, in its consciousness, in its power, and its ananda. That's what he goes on saying. And it would be unlimited. There would be, although it can see the variations, it is always conscious of the oneness of things. In the background of its consciousness, there is oneness of things. But in the physical world, it is dealing with the differentiation. Because if they had only the, suppose mother and children though, have the only the unitarian consciousness and not the sense of differentiation, how will they talk to you and me? If I am talking to you, she will not know whether she is talking to you or to somebody else. Differentiation has to be there. So that is there, but the at the background of the mind, there is always a sense of unity, that everything is one. This is a very interesting example given by Ramakrishna when he says that you must always have the presence of the divine in your mind. Then when you say that, suppose I am reading the Life Divine, how can I remember the divine? So he gives a very interesting example. He says it's like a maid servant working in a house, okay? She is sweeping the floor, she is cleaning the vessel, she is doing the cooking, she is doing everything, but she has a 2-year-old child at home and she is worried about that child. Whatever she is doing, that memory of the child is there and hoping that he is safe and sound. At the background of your consciousness, that is there, and you are dealing with the differentiation and the different forms in the physical world. So that is possible. So that is somewhat like this. You are conscious of the oneness of things all the time, but you are also capable of dealing with the differentiation in the physical world. And unity and differentiation in what way? In substance, in knowledge, in power, and in ananda. That's what he's saying. Your ananda will be my ananda, but your ananda will be different from hers, and I will experience both. In fact, I will experience everybody's ananda in a different way, and yet knowing fully that all the ananda is only one. Similarly, again, the power of people. Again, the consciousness also of people, everybody, everything. Differentiation as well as unity.
Also in action.
Yes. That's what I mean by substance. In the physical itself also. He'll be aware of all the time that the substance has taken different shapes and different forms, essentially the same. That's what he's saying. And you can see that his constant stress throughout Life Divine, whenever he's talking, Sat, Chit, Shakti, Ananda, he is constantly dealing with all the four elements. Okay, here also you will see the same. It would be, so, around 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 lines maybe from the top, okay? But the Divine Soul, would not be enslaved to this divorce and duality. It sees the duality, but it is not bound to see the duality only. It is aware of the oneness, it sees the duality also. It would be aware in itself at once of the infinite self-concentration and the infinite self-extension. The infinite self-concentration, the oneness, and the infinite self-extension and diffusion, the multiplicity in the physical world. It would be aware simultaneously of the one in its unitarian consciousness, holding the innumerable multiplicity in itself as if potential, unexpressed, and therefore to our mental experience of that state non-existent, and of the one in its extended consciousness, holding the multiplicity thrown out and active as the play of its own conscious being. It is aware of the oneness producing the multiplicity and supporting the multiplicity. If the oneness is not there, the multiplicity will be really an illusion. But it is not really an illusion because the supermind is holding it all together. And that's exactly what happens. The ascetic is not going up to the supermind level. He is going only up to the overmind level maximum. Therefore, he sees the physical world as really an illusion. And that experience is valid for him. But when you go to the supramental level, that won't be an illusion at all. It will be a reality, but of a different grade of reality. Then he goes to the next one. Will and active. It would equally be aware of the many, ever drawing down to themselves the one, that is the eternal source and reality of their existence, and of the many ever mounting up, attracted to the one, that is the eternal culmination and blissful justification of all their play of difference. That's an interesting thing. So if I am looking at you, if I am in that consciousness, I will see that you have come from there and that your ultimate journey will be to go back there. For each one, I will be able to see that. That's what he's saying.
No judgment.
Yeah.
No judgment.
Yeah.
No judgment.
No judgment at all. You can see the reality that you're coming from there and going back.
Yes.
Then, ever drawing to himself, the one that is the eternal source and reality of their existence, and of the many ever mounting up, attracted to the one that is the eternal culmination and blissful justification for all their play of difference. This vast view of things is the mold of truth consciousness. Truth consciousness, again, the supermind. The foundation of the large truth and right. So, again, he is using truth and right, rita chit. Satyam ritam brihat. So, he is again referring back to the Vedas. Hymned by the Vedic seers, there you are, hymned by the Vedic seers, this unity of all these terms of opposition is the real Advaita. The supreme comprehending word of the knowledge of the unknowable. He is talking of the real Advaita because the Advaita of Mayavada also is an Advaita. They are seeing that the ultimate is one reality and all this that you see here is not the reality, it's only an illusion. But he is meaning the real Advaita is that this also is real, that also is real. Different in forms, but...
I find that phrase hymned by the Vedic seers so beautiful. They sang it. They didn't speak it, they sang it.
Hymned.
Hymned.
And he considers, so just imagine, Sri Ramdo's poetry, he is such a poet. He has appreciation of English poetry, he can understand the rhythm and the stress. But he is into French poetry, he is into Latin poetry, he is into Greek poetry and Sanskrit, even the rhythm, and he is understanding the rhythm. Although his, I don't know if his pronunciation of Sanskrit was as it should be, because he had a British accent. Even his Bengali was not up to the mark when he used to speak. But so far as poetry is concerned, he understands perfectly. He says the very high standard of poetry in the Vedas.
Yes.
Yeah. Inspiration. I think I have messed up.
Yeah, you missed 5-6 lines of the beginning of the paragraph.
So, from where do I start now?
Moreover.
Okay,
moreover.
That's right. I started reading towards the end. Moreover, such a divine soul would live simultaneously in the two terms of the eternal existence of Satchidananda. The two inseparable poles of the self-unfolding of the Absolute, which we call the One and the Many. The One is the Spirit, the Many is the Universe. Or very often, they use the word Spirit and Matter, the two end terms. Okay. All being does really so live, but to our divided self-awareness, there is an incompatibility, a gulf between the two driving us towards a choice to dwell either in the multiplicity, exiled from the direct and entire consciousness of the one, or in the unity, repellent of the consciousness of the many. So, in fact, he is saying that either this or that, but a yogi can live mostly, a human being can live only at one level at a time. A yogi can manage to live at 2-3 levels at the same time. That is also possible for him. And Ramakrishna has an interesting word for that. Those who are capable of only living at certain planes of consciousness and those who are capable of taking their consciousness to any level by their own will. They can come, station themselves here, they can station themselves there, okay, as they want. So, he calls them Jiva Koti and Ishvara Koti. Jiva Koti is the one who is stuck at one level or maximum two levels perhaps of consciousness. But Ishvara Koti is one who can place himself at any level he wants to. So, Sri Ramdo will be at the overmind, supermind level, but he can bring his consciousness down with his will even to the ordinary level. Mother speaks of this in the agenda. She says that my consciousness is there, but often I have to bring it down here to deal with certain things. And she says that when I bring it down here, I experience the pain and all that.
Yes.
Yeah. And when I am there, it is total bliss. Why does she have to bring it down here? Because she has to deal with the transformation of the body. She has to deal with the body.
But can the Jiva Koti evolve into the Ishvara Koti? Can the Jiva Koti evolve into the Ishvara
Koti? Of course. The evolution of human beings is always possible. In fact, normally in India, when a yogi goes to the Nirvana experience, he is more than satisfied and disappears into the infinite. He is not interested in anything more. But people like Swamiji say, wait, I want more, I want more, I want more.
Now, in this first, well, in this sentence, he says, all being does really so live.
Yeah, that's
so
right.
So we all do live like that.
Yes, but we are not conscious of it.
But we're not conscious of it.
That's it.
Exactly.
Because we have, our soul, our self is there also. Yes. It is part of our own consciousness.
Yes.
But we are not conscious of it. I explain this to the children in this way. I say that think of yourself as a seven-storied house. Okay? You are living on the ground floor. The walls are grimy. Sometimes the doors and windows are also closed and the lighting is poor and you have to struggle to see things. You can, if you want. And the plot is your own, which is your individuality. The 60-40 plot is your own. The floors above, depending on how conscious you are, have already been built or you have the potentiality to build the top floors. That's what yoga is all about. So put that way, then it becomes clear that the potentiality is always there for everybody, but they have to be built. Swamiji often talks of this. He says that the potentiality is there, but you have to formulate and clearly make that operational, that consciousness. So when you often go there, there is a confusion. I'll give you an example of this confusion that can happen. There used to be a gentleman here, I mean a very easy example to understand. His name was Benjamin. He was a French, local Tamil, but a Christian. His name was Benjamin. He used to speak French. When he passed, he used to make mattresses and caps for us. And he used to be in the, now where the children's dispensary is. He used to live there. And he used to make mattresses, pillows, and all these things, and caps. He also had, in the 1930s, six cycles, which he used to, you have to take mother's permission to use the cycle. We want to go to lake today for artists, for painting purposes, things like that. Mother would give the permission. This gentleman, when he used to go to mother, is there in the agenda, okay? He used to go to mother, he used to comb his hair absolutely flat. She used to comb his hair and go to mother like that, okay? Then mother is saying, when he passed away, he didn't know that he has passed away. And when he used to come to me in his subtle body and complain to me, then why are they messing up my room? They are doing this, they are doing that, they are changing all my arrangements and all that. And when he used to come in his subtle body, that hair used to be also combed exactly like that. Which means that there is a relation between the subtle body and the gross body. So you get confused sometimes when you are in another consciousness. To consciously be there is something, it's quite different.
But how was he combing his subtle hair?
Huh?
How was he combing his subtle hair?
With a subtle comb. Yeah, that's it. I'll tell you what, it's interesting because Amal has a very interesting experience. That's an interesting question. Amal says that one day when he was reading a book, he was falling asleep. Okay? And when he was falling asleep, he could clearly see that he's going into the subtle. Okay? Then he says, my experimental mind started working. I am seeing the physical page mark in the book and I am also seeing the subtle page mark in the book. So he says, I wanted to make an experiment. I wanted to pull out with my physical hand the subtle page mark. You follow? And to my surprise, no, sorry, I am saying the opposite. I wanted to pull out the physical page mark with my subtle hand. And when I did that, to my surprise, I saw that the subtle hand is pulling out only the subtle page mark and not the physical one. The physical one remained where it was. So that should answer your question.
Mm.
So these grades of matter are there.
Yes.
Subtler and subtler, subtler
yes.
and subtler.
Subtler and subtler. Exactly, it is very easy to understand because usually I use the experience of ice, water and water vapor.
So the Gita calls the divine at one place as Anoh Aniyam, means subtler than the subtlest.
Yes.
So
that's
this
the ether.
Is the way in which we can understand it.
Yeah, that's the ether. And the ether is so subtle that neither the science nor some Indian philosophers, they don't accept the existence of ether.
Yes, yes, very true.
They don't accept.
Very true.
It is so subtle.
So the divine is beyond even the ether, no? Because the ether is part of the apara prakriti. And then the apara prakriti itself comes from the para and the para itself comes from the supreme.
See, you have a habit of intellectualizing too much.
Okay.
That's the problem.
Okay.
Because when we are thinking with the mind, we want clarity and we want divisions.
No?
So, according to me, the ether is the subtlest.
No, what I am saying is not what's from my own thing. I have read it in one of the volumes of Sri Aurobindo. And he says that you can imagine this ocean of material energy like two concentric circles. So the ocean of material energy is one and it is surrounded by an ocean of consciousness force.
Yes.
So the ocean of material energy is the apara prakriti, of which ether is the first element, and the ocean of consciousness force is the para prakriti, whom we call the mother. And she in turn comes from the divine itself. So I am saying only that there will be two more links to the divine, and ether itself won't be the highest divine. That's all I am trying to say.
Okay.
It's the highest of the elements.
Yeah.
But what you are saying is that there is a substance and you are saying there is a layer of consciousness. But keep in mind that consciousness, substance, force and ananda are all one. That don't forget. They are all one. They are not separate. So to keep that in mind. Here in the physical world, we experience them as separate. But they are actually all one. So, this para is okay. All being, Narada's question was, all being does really so live. That means we live in the entire range. That's right.
Mm-hmm.
But we are not conscious of it. So, all being so live. But to our divided self-awareness, there is an incompatibility, a gulf between the two, driving us towards a choice. To dwell either in the multiplicity, exiled from the direct and entire consciousness of the one, or in the unity, repellent of the consciousness of the many. We can't. Those who are avatars, they'll be living in both at the same time. The divine soul can live at the same time in both. But the divine soul would not be enslaved to this divorce and duality. It would be aware in itself at once of the infinite self-concentration and the infinite self-extension and division. Now, he is using different words. Self-concentration, the one. Okay? And the infinite self-extension and diffusion, the many. He is using different words, and this gives us a clue as to how to read Sri Aurobindo. You have to see very, very carefully the words. The self-concentration, obviously, is the one. He is meaning the one. And the self-diffusion is obviously the many. Okay. It would be aware simultaneously of the one in its unitarian consciousness, holding the innumerable multiplicity in itself as if potential, exactly like the seed. The seed is one, holding the potential of all the fruits and flowers and trees and bark and roots and whatnot, everything. But you don't see it there. It comes out and expresses itself. If as a potential, unexpressed, and therefore to our mental experience of that state, non-existent, and of the one in its extended consciousness, holding the multiplicity thrown out and active as the play of its own conscious being, will and delight. There you are, see, being is substance, will is force, and delight is ananda. It would equally be aware of the many, ever drawing down to themselves the one, that is the eternal source and reality of their existence, and of the many ever mounting up, attracted to the one, that is the eternal culmination and blissful justification of all their play of difference. He would be seeing the, for each individual, he will be seeing the entire range, right from the top to the bottom. From the top, the involution, and from the bottom, the evolution. Yeah, we read that. And so the next is, this vast view of things is the mold of the truth consciousness, the foundation of the large truth and right hymned by the Vedic seers. This unity of all these terms of opposition is the real Advaita, the supreme comprehending word of the knowledge of the unknowable. The real Advaita does not see illusion. The later Advaita, he always speaks of the earlier Vedanta and the later Vedanta. The later Vedanta is referring to 8th century Shankara. And the earlier Vedanta, 3000 years earlier, the Vedas and the Upanishads. Okay? The divine soul will be aware of all variation of being, consciousness, will and delight, as the outflowing, the extension, the diffusion of that self-concentrated unity, developing itself, not into difference and division, but into another, an extended form of infinite oneness. It will itself always be concentrated in oneness, in the essence of its being, and always manifested in variation, in the extension of its being. All that takes form in itself will be the manifested potentialities of the One, the Word or Name, vibrating out of the nameless silence, the form realizing the formless essence, the active will or power proceeding out of the tranquil force, the ray of self-cognition of gleaming out from the sun of timeless self-awareness, the wave of becoming rising up into shape of self-conscious existence out of the eternally self-conscious being, the joy and love welling forever out of the eternal still delight. It will be the absolute bayoun in its self-unfolding, and each relativity in it will be absolute to itself because aware of itself as the absolute manifested, but without that ignorance which excludes other relativities as alien to its being or less complete than itself. A very interesting paragraph.
Yes, yes.
We'll have a go sentence by sentence. So, the divine soul will be aware of all variation of being. In other words, the variation of being will be real to it. All the multiplicity it will be seeing is real. Not like the ascetic, the unreal. It will be real. Consciousness, will and delight. So, look at the sentence. Again, he is coming back to the same thing. Variation of being, variation of substance. Variation of consciousness, chit. Variation of will, shakti. Variation of delight, ananda. So, yeah. Constantly he will use all these.
Yes, yes.
Okay, so, as the outflowing, the extension, the diffusion of that self-concentrated unity, developing itself not into difference and division, but into another, an extended form of infinite oneness.
Beautiful line.
So this oneness which is there, like the seed, slowly it is going into fruits, flowers, leaves, branches, twigs, etc. But it is still the tree, the whole.
And everything is going towards oneness.
Yes. The oneness is there, is expressed even in each different thing also has got the oneness in it. This is very easy to understand by our biological body. Each cell contains the RNA and the DNA which can reconstruct the whole. So that's exactly it. Each unit of multiplicity contains the whole. Biologically, it's a fact. So, it's 10 times more true in the spiritual fields. The infinite and the finite are absolutely related to each other. They are never divorced from each other. Each one contains the other.
I think what you're saying is that this stem cell,
yeah,
which can become any kind of cell,
yes,
and reconstruct the being.
Yes. Yeah. No, I'm saying that's I'm saying, but even the cell,
any cell in the body,
yeah, any cell in the body has got the RNA and the DNA which can reconstruct the whole. The characteristics of everything is there stored in the RNA and the DNA, the spirals. Okay, each little bit tells you what it is: the color of your hair, the color of your skin, the color, the shape of your nose, the color of your eyes, the bone structure, how big it will be. Everything is stored in the DNA, and that.
In primitive forms of the chameleon and iguana.
Yes.
They can reconstruct the tail.
Yes. That's right.
So the DNA multiplies itself.
The
DNA is capable of multiplying itself.
No, not multiplying, but it contains the whole. Given the right conditions, that one cell develops into the whole. No? And when it is developing into the many, each one, the totality is there even in the finite. That's the whole idea. In the infinite, the potentiality of the finite is there. And in the finite, the potentiality of the infinite is there.
Basically, self-extension.
Yes, that's right. Somewhat like take a bit of extended gas and compress it. It is still that same gas, but it can also extend itself to the whole thing again. Okay, so. Then, an extended form of infinite oneness. It will itself always be concentrated in oneness in the essence of its being. What he's saying here can be applicable to everything, even at the biological level. It will itself be always concentrated in oneness in the essence of its being. The essence is each cell. It will be there. Essentially, the totality is there in every finite element. Always manifested. In other words, each individual can become the divine, the whole. That also is there. Okay, so it will itself always be concentrated in oneness in the essence of its being, always manifested in variation in the extension of its being. The extension of its being, the oneness is extending itself without losing its oneness. All that takes form in itself will be the manifested potentialities of the one. If you think of the tree and the seed and the tree, very easy to understand what he's saying. All that takes form in itself will be the manifested potentialities of the one. The word or name vibrating out of the nameless silence. This is again what he says, the silence of the self produces all the forms of the physical world. The movement is possible only because of the static silence, which is the origin. It is from there that everything is coming out.
And he has word and name.
Name, yeah.
All kept.
Yeah. Word and name. Name is the most exterior form of anything. Nama Rupa. But he's using the word word also, because word is the one that creates the form. Word with a W cap is the power of the divine to create forms. Why? You can also think of it in this way. That's what I explain to the children. Okay? I have a thought in my mind. I don't express it. It's unmanifested. When I speak out my thought, it gets manifested. And when I'm speaking out my thoughts, what am I doing? I'm using words. So, that which is unmanifested, by the word it can be manifested. The power of manifestation is the word.
In the Christian theology we have...
The same.
In the beginning was the word.
That's right.
And the word was made flesh.
Yes, that's right. So the word represents the power to manifest anything. And in our Indian philosophy, you call it Nama and Rupa. That is the most exterior form of you. You are called Narad. But that, when you say Narad, I can understand what you're talking about. But I can use another name for you. I can say Richard. And that doesn't change anything in you. So the name is the outermost form of what you are. Mm-hmm. And that's your body, mind, life. Yeah. So when they, all the physical forms in the physical world are nama and rupa. Here he is using the word. Okay. There. The form, realizing the formless essence, the active will or power proceeding out of the tranquil force, the ray of self-recognition, self-cognition, gleaming out from the sun of timeless self-awareness, wave of becoming, rising up into shape of self-conscious existence out of the eternally self-conscious being, the joy and love welling forever out of the eternal still delight. Again, he is using all the four terms of the Satchidananda. Go back and see what he is saying. All that takes form in itself will be the manifested potential of the One. The word or name vibrating out of the nameless silence. So, the form realizing the formless essence. The formless essence is becoming form. Okay? Then, the active will or power, now we talk of Shakti, proceeding out of the tranquil force, that which is at the highest level is force, but it is held back. I usually tell the children to think of the horses before a race. Okay, the stiles are down and the horses are all ready to go. They are motionless. But can we say that they have no force? Of course not. They have force, but it is held back. So there is this silent force that he's talking about, and when it is released, it comes down and creates the many, the multiplicity of the world. That's a silent force. Silence at this level is lack of force. But at that level, force at that silent, when it is there, it is full of force, but held back. Like the water behind the dam. Also, it is static, but it's not without force. Let it come out, it gushes out with huge force. So that's what he's saying here. He's using the word, the tranquil force. The active will or power proceeding out of the tranquil force. The ray of self-cognition, recognizing itself, gleaming out of this sun of timeless self-awareness. The wave of becoming, rising up into shape of self-conscious existence out of the eternally self-conscious being. Now look, self-conscious being, he is using the word being here as substance. So out of this substance which is conscious of itself comes out the becoming. The being becomes becoming. Becoming is the movement, being is the static condition. Being and becoming. Okay? The joy and love welling forever out of the eternal still delight. So, every time it is, whether it is consciousness or substance or Shakti, it is still and it is creating the movement here. In the, so, Sat becomes still Sat, still substance becomes substance of movement and form here. Still consciousness becomes movement of consciousness here. Shakti, which is silent Shakti, becomes full of movement here and also Ananda. That's what he's saying. Then, finally he's saying, it will be the absolute Bayun. Now that's interesting. The word Bayun means two in one. It doesn't mean two. It means two in one. Like a triune means three in one. Both are there. Three is there as well as one. Okay. In itself unfolding. And each relativity in it will be absolute to itself, because aware of itself as the absolute, manifested, but without that ignorance which excludes other relativities as alien to its being, or else complete than, less complete than?
Than itself.
Yeah, or less complete than itself. So, at our level, we are not conscious of the oneness, but the divine soul will be fully conscious of its oneness as well as all the multiplicity. That last bit is talking of our condition, manifested without that ignorance, our ignorance which excludes other relativities. You are excluded from me at the physical level, at the consciousness level, at the Ananda level, your Ananda is yours, mine is mine. But the divine consciousness will feel everything to be part of itself.
Can we use the words Purusha and Prakriti for that absolute vayum, like static and movement all the time? So, can we think...
At there, Purusha and Prakriti become one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, but like in this whole sentence, all that is silent. Can we think of the word Purusha for that silence, and for all that is motion, can we think the word Prakriti? Means
Of course.
To relate to those words.
Yes, of course.
Right.
But interesting thing is that at that highest level, that silent force is Purusha and Prakriti both together.
Yeah.
At the supramental level, they become one.
So this Bayun is basically the static and dynamic as one.
Yes. Because at the lower level also, it is one. At the higher level also, it is one.
Yeah.
But there is a slight difference, because at the higher level, the oneness contains the many. And in the lower, the many contains the one in essence. It's a reversal.
The reality is oneness, basically. The reality is oneness.
Yes. No. The reality is oneness as well as multiplicity.
No, but the fundamental thing is oneness. Despite all the appearances, the fundamental thing is oneness.
If you are insisting on that, we would have to call you the ascetic who is talking of the Mayavada philosophy. Very same though, and the Isha Upanishad is very clear. Both are real and both are equally important. But in one chapter we saw that there is a priority.
Yeah, exactly.
There is a priority. That priority is a very interesting word.
Yeah.
That is more fundamental than this.
That's what I was trying to say.
Yes. But you mustn't underplay the importance of the multiplicity.
Mm-hmm.
It's the divine wanting to see everything from one angle. But divine says, I want to see everything from 100,000 million angles.
So multiplicity is equally real.
Yes. In fact, in the Taittiriya Upanishad, Eko ham bahusyam. Let me be many. I am one. Let me be many.
Yes.
He wants to see in different ways. He wants to see how you would see. He would want to see how you would see. I want to see in 100,000 million ways what I have created.
That's the play.
That's a play, exactly. The ananda of the play. So anyway, the divine soul, he is making it very clear now. It has got the consciousness of the one, it has got the consciousness of the many. And it is not slave to either of them. Nor is it slave to oneness, nor is it slave to the... And this in four ways. Substance, consciousness, force, as well as ananda.
Why is he using the word adjective in front of divine? Oh, in front of the word soul. The soul is divine. So why is it titled the divine soul? What does he want to specify?
You have a soul?
Yes.
Is it divine now?
Yes.
It's not.
Why not?
It is sleeping.
Achha,
that's what he means. It's an awakened soul is a divine soul.
Okay.
But in human beings, it is a sleeping soul. It's not aware. It's not divine. It's a seed.
But not yet manifest.
The seed is not the tree yet.
Mm-hmm.
That's what he means.
And as I said the other night, I feel that the divine soul is the supermental.
Yes.
Able to come up and descend.
That's
Ishwara Koti. The divine soul.
Yes.
Divine soul is the supermental. He is describing the supermental soul.
Exactly.
Which has come down and gone up and not subject to the ignorance.
Thank you, Ram.